Sounds great. All right, well, welcome and thank you for joining us for the Coastal Resilience Grants Webinar Series. This series is designed to highlight the completed projects that are funded by the Coastal Resilience Grants Program, and we have a great deal of great information to share with you today. We're joined by the folks who worked on the Resilient Cape Cod project, which investigated the environmental and socioeconomic effects of potential coastal resilience strategies. Strategies designed to lower the area's vulnerability to sea level rise, storm surge, and erosion. So a big part of this effort was the development of the Cape Cod Coastal Planner, which we'll hear quite a bit about today. As I mentioned, we have quite a bit of information to share, and we'll have a lot of presentation time today. If you are able to put your questions in the chat box, we will take one or two questions after each of our four speakers. And if we don't get to your question in between the speakers, we may be able to answer it if there's time at the end. And if not, the team is also happy to get back with you offline for further information. First, we have Erin Perry, who is with the Cape Cod Commission and has been for the last 8 years. She served originally as the Special Project Manager, and now she is the Deputy Director. So Erin manages the regional planning efforts at the program level and engages communities during the planning process to build consensus. So I will pass it over to Erin.
Thank you very much, and thanks a lot for having us today. We're excited to do this webinar. I'll just get started by providing a little bit of an overview of the Cape Cod Commission, a little bit about Cape Cod itself, and then a little bit about the broad kind of plan for the Resilient Cape Cod project. So for those of you who aren't familiar with us, the Cape Cod Commission is a regional planning agency. We were established by an act of the Massachusetts legislature in 1990. All areas in Massachusetts have a regional planning agency, but the commission is unique in that we have regulatory authority. We're one of only two that have such authority. And our mission is broad. It's to protect the unique values and quality of life on Cape Cod by coordinating a balanced relationship between environmental protection and economic progress. Cape Cod covers about 400 square miles of land and has more than 560 miles of vulnerable tidal coastline. We've got about 215,000 year-round residents, but on any given day in the summer, that number can nearly triple. About 85% of our land area is either already protected or already developed. And we have about 162,000 housing units, which are primarily in the form of sprawling single-family residential development. Access to our region is primarily by vehicle. So we have two vehicle bridges coming onto the Cape, four lanes coming on and four going off. They were built in the 1930s. And so at a time when the vehicle traffic we see today wasn't necessarily anticipated. And we face a lot of challenges with that, particularly if we were to ever see a severe weather event that requires residents and visitors evacuate, these bridges present quite a challenge. As a region, we have a lot at stake along the coast. About 19% of the region's land area is within the floodplain. There's potentially over $28 billion in assessed value at risk in this area. That includes about 15,000 residences, worth about $13 billion in assessed value. We have over 400 miles of roadway in the floodplain, about 2,900 parcels worth about $3.5 billion would become isolated by a 2-foot sea level rise due to flooded roadways. About 30% of the town's identified critical facilities are located in the floodplain. So these are things like our fire stations, police stations, healthcare facilities, critical assets that provide really safety and emergency response to our community. And over 1,500 inventory structures are also located in the floodplain. If you look at the uninventoried historic structures, it's closer to 2,300. Located in the floodplain. And these buildings and historic features are so critical to the character of our communities, and so they also present a challenge in terms of our broader community systems. We have about 1,400 acres of salt marsh in the floodplain, and in many places, migration of those salt marshes will be inhibited by development. We've got about 9,600 acres of barrier beaches that are also susceptible to sea level rise, storm surge, and erosion. We're at risk of losing some of this critical natural infrastructure that protects our built and community systems in the region. So in 2015, we applied for a NOAA Coastal Resiliency Grant to fund a dedicated regional effort to address our coastal hazards and really support a more resilient region. Our goal for the Resilient Cape Cod project was to investigate the environmental and socioeconomic effects of local and regional coastal resiliency strategies. And the project included several key components. You'll hear about all of them today, but it included the development of a database of adaptation strategies, a region-wide stakeholder engagement process, development of an online decision support tool, the Cape Cod Coastal Planner, and a pilot project with the town of Barnstable. We had several partners, including the Waquoit Bay National Estuarine Research Reserve, who you'll hear from in just a few minutes, the Association to Preserve Cape Cod, and the town of Barnstable with that pilot project. And we're also supported by a number of agencies, including the Center for Coastal Studies, Woods Hole Sea Grant and Cape Cod Cooperative Extension, and the Massachusetts Office of Coastal Zone Management. When we set out to begin the project, we recognized that in addition to the expertise we have in-house and through our partnerships on the project, that it was clear that we needed to engage a broader range of experts in various components of the project. So we put an advisory board in place to provide advice on the overall approach and key decisions throughout the project. We established a science committee to provide access to data on natural hazards and to help interpret climate, weather, and coastal geology data. We also established an adaptation strategies committee to review the strategies database and advise the project team on how to apply strategies across the Cape. And we established a regulatory and legal committee to ensure the implementation of appropriate strategies across the region. And the final committee is one that we didn't use to the same extent as the others, but are representatives that we could bring together in the future as Cape Cod towns seek to move forward with the resiliency projects that they identify locally. And then we also knew that we needed to engage stakeholders region-wide to both share information on the project, on the coastal hazards that we face as a region, and on the strategies to address those hazards, and to gather feedback on the project as well. So just as important as sharing information with the stakeholders, we really tried to structure a process to get information back from them as well. So that's kind of a segue. I'll pause here for a moment and happy to answer some questions on the kind of the overview of the region and the process project. But then I'll turn it over to Tonna Marie Rogers to talk more about the stakeholder process.
Erin, we have one question from the chat box that is, by floodplain, are you referring to the 100-year Atlas 14 floodplain?
Yes, we are.
Okay, great. And also in the chat box. And Erin, thank you very much for that overview. And now we'll pass it on to Tonna Marie Rogers, who is the director at the Waquoit Bay National Estuarine Research Reserve. And she works at the Nexus of Science, Coastal Management, and Policy. Before she was director, she led the CTP, the Coastal Training Program at the Reserve, where she focused on bringing science-based information and process skills to decision makers. Tonna Marie, it's all you.
Hi, good afternoon. And I am really excited to be part of the team this afternoon presenting to you about the work of the Resilient Cape Cod Project. My role on the project was really to work with the team to identify stakeholders who we could integrate into the whole process. Design a stakeholder engagement process, and then work with the team to facilitate meetings and gathering stakeholder input at various junctures on the project, and really to have this be a thread all the way through from both the design and concept phase of the project all the way through to implementation. And so this afternoon, what I'd like to do for you is start out by just giving you a backdrop of when we entered into this project in 2015, you have to put your mind in the framework of what knowledge was like then about coastal hazards and coastal change, and what our stakeholder community at large on the Cape were thinking at that time about these types of issues. And so Erin, in her introduction, talked about the fact that we have about 215,000 year-round residents, but that also includes visitors that can expand that number to a great deal, as well as people who own, property and only live here or come and visit at for a short period of time out of the year. So when you look at that backdrop, you're really talking about a diverse range of people, some who live here year-round, some who are just coming for a very short period, and some who might have living other places of the year that are not very much like Cape Cod. So we had to take that into account. And so we had two big challenges. How do we effectively educate a population about coastal risks and then motivate them to want to act on these risks? How do we create a true decision support tool that was not just be checking the box for a technical accomplishment, but something that communities could actually apply and understand and involve in their work? And what we do know about our stakeholder community when we started this project is that there were other issues that they ranked in terms of when we did surveys before as being more highly important to them in terms of like issues like water quality. Not that they didn't think these coastal hazards and climate change impacts were important, but they just weren't top of the list. But also we realized that it was a growing area of interest where stakeholders recognized that there needed to be more outreach and education on these topics. And they were particularly interested in learning more about how these hazards affected them, what the research could do to better prepare, as well as about ecosystem services and making sure that we were maintaining an eye on that. So that's kind of a quick backdrop of our stakeholder knowledge base. So why use a stakeholder-driven process? As I said, we kind of threaded this piece as a glue in our project. And we felt because of social science research that has been done in many different arenas that has shown that when you use stakeholder-driven process and you're really intentional about getting stakeholder input and engaging stakeholders to give feedback and to really understand their questions, their concerns, and to have them understand how these types of resources that we are creating could be relevant to them, it really ups your chance of success. It really ups the opportunity for stakeholders to be able to implement what you're developing throughout the project at the end of it and not just have these materials sit on the shelf or on a website. And so we felt it was important to use a stakeholder-driven process to enhance awareness, to increase relevancy of the topic to them, and to ensure that stakeholders could really connect to why understanding coastal hazards and change and understanding climate change impacts and how the region could prepare to deal with these was relevant to them, how it connected with their lives and their work. Increase legitimacy and credibility of the products that we were developing, because if stakeholders do not understand these products, they don't understand the information that was used to create them, they don't understand the questions that we investigated throughout, it doesn't lend itself for great application. But using a stakeholder-driven process ups the chances that stakeholders will be invested in using these materials and will actually apply it in their work. And we also had another goal of really creating ambassadors. We really were not just about doing this three-year project, creating these products, patting ourselves on the back and telling NOAA we did a great job. We really wanted to create ambassadors and by that increase the ripple effect where we knew that there were a group of people that had walked with us through the journey of this project and were really invested in the products and could become influencers of change in their own communities, be able to be, when we're not there explaining about the coastal planner or about the adaptation strategies matrix, there would be other people in the community that could be connecting with others in their community and with this team and carrying the impact of the work forward. So that's why we wanted to use a stakeholder-driven process. I wanted to take a minute to just explain what the process was, how we designed the process, and what was involved. So very quickly, as I said, we very much linked stakeholder input at every phase of the project. And you could see that reflected in every tool and every task that we did on the project. Explicitly, we created three stakeholder groups, sub-regional groups where we divided participants along the coastal waters that they were most closely connected to around Cape Cod. So here on the right, you see a graphic showing different bays around Cape Cod area. And so we bucketed our stakeholders within those groups. And then we had stakeholder meetings in those sub-regions. We also created a specific group that we named the tool beta tester group. And I'll tell you a little bit more about those further down, that group that was designed particularly to give input on the decision support tool that we'll be hearing about a little bit more later. And then we also had a pilot group of municipal officials from the town of Barnstable who we walked through an exercise of using this tool and really thinking about its application in a municipal setting. And so overall, when we lumped everything together, we had about 17 meetings. It was very meeting heavy, but very interactive and very inspirational. We had 50 meeting hours overall, 12 sectors represented. It was important to us to have a very diverse group, lots of different perspectives at the table to weigh in these discussions. And I think we accomplished that very well. And about 120 unique attendees in the sub-regional groups. That does not include people that were involved in the tool beta tester group, as well as the pilot efforts afterwards. I want to give you a flavor of what we did when we had all these meetings with stakeholders. This was a chance for us to be able to really walk stakeholders through. We started out with having three meetings in each sub-region, and each of these meetings were designed to kind of connect topics one to the next. The first meeting really focused on having people build an understanding of the coastal system on Cape Cod. As I said, we have a diverse group of stakeholders with very different knowledge levels about these issues. So really painting the baseline of what the Cape Cod coastal environment was like, what threats we faced, what we were vulnerable to, why we were vulnerable to it, and what we could do to address that. So our meetings really started out by giving that baseline information. We made sure that we integrated local case studies a lot so that people could learn from what was tried in the region to adapt and prepare for coastal change and what was learned. And so those resources you'll hear about a little bit later too that were integrated into the adaptation strategies matrix. We spent a lot of time as a team talking about these various adaptation strategies that the community could look at. At the end of the day, this project is about helping Cape Cod adapt to coastal change. And so at the heart of it was looking at strategies that could be regionally relevant and walk through with stakeholders what it meant to use different strategies in their region, what could be applicable, what would not be applicable, and why. Connected to this was also really getting a good understanding of what our community valued. What did different people really want to see maintained over time for Cape Cod? What was their vision into the future of what Cape Cod would look like, what the coastal environment should look like, and what should we be preserving and being stewards of? We also talked about drivers and processes for local actions. At the end of the day, we were creating resources and a tool to be applied in the community. So we wanted our stakeholders to be able to give us input on what would make application of these materials easier in the community. What drove local change and what should we be mindful of? We also did a very iterative process with reviewing and designing the tool that Jen will talk more about later, so I won't spend much time on it here, but this was a key part of getting stakeholder input. And one of the things we also did was to look at other places where we could use resources, videos, stories of change when we brought some of that into the conversation with our stakeholders so that we were not just talking about Cape Cod, even though that was our focus, but we were learning about lessons from other places and what that meant and having our stakeholders really see change impact another region and then make the connection to what would that feel like happening here on the ground on Cape Cod. And so some of the discussion questions that we posed to them, let me just go back, one, were what are important characteristics to consider when exploring options that protect Cape Cod's coastal areas? What do Cape Coders value about their natural environment and about the built environment? What people didn't want to see change, what they want to see maintained, and what sparks a community to act on resiliency issues? And it was really important as we are talking about resiliency here, because one of the things that came out very early on in the project is that as we were doing these interactive components with stakeholders and having them rank things and walk through the process and really raise their questions, we realized that even the word resiliency meant different things to different people. And for some people, it was a barrier at the start of the project, even using that term. But as we went through the process, it became a much more comfortable term for people to use. And I just put up here one of the word clouds that we did with stakeholders to just dig down into people's understanding of what that term even meant since we're using it that much. And it shows you here that adaptability is something that really was on the mind of people, really wanting to be able to know that they could understand these areas of change that we were being faced, the threats that we were exposed to, but how to adapt and to remain strong and resilient as a community is one of the things that's at the top of the mind of our community members. Then creating a useful tool. Here I talked about the fact that this was one component that we did a special group for, and this group was about 15 or so people with technical experts as well as community members, local officials who could use this tool, and they really helped to give feedback on designing the tool. And I want to say this process started out with the tool was just a concept. Now it's an actual living, breathing thing. Well, it's not breathing, but you know what I mean. And so it was very inspirational to see that process really take shape, and stakeholders were critical at every juncture. They gave input on functionality and what outputs should look like. They helped to fine-tune every single aspect. And for this, I feel like kudos to the team at the Cape Cod Commission and others who took everything and really integrated all those comments into the tool. Another thing that the team created was a story map. We felt it was important to have a place where stakeholders could really connect with coastal hazards and impacts that they were seeing in their own communities and on the Cape Cod shoreline. And so this was a place where people could go out, they could take pictures, they could upload them and really share stories of change. Because sometimes when you don't go through an impact or one has happened a long time ago, you forget about it. But having a place where it can serve as a repository of that information and being able to tell the story in a visual, powerful format. This story map still lives today. It's up, it's here. We've used it in every meeting. The Cape Cod Commission continues to show that at workshops that they do, so that it continues to be a tool that stakeholders can use to show resiliency on Cape Cod and what it means to plan for that. And then lastly, I wanted to end with just a slide. As you go through the process of really working with through stakeholders, it's very important to really figure out how was that information used. When you get people together in a lot of meetings and they're giving a lot of input, here's how our team incorporated that impact. It was helpful to take a pulse on Cape Cod's understanding of these issues because it helped her team design things to meet their information needs. It was helpful to prioritize adaptation strategies that you'll hear about next. It was helpful to capture sub-regional specificities and things that we heard about in one region we didn't hear about highlighted in another. It was very, very, very important to understand that not every sub-region thought about the issues in the same way. Tool development application, this was a core of what we did with our stakeholder group, from technical aspects to messaging to identify who the core user groups would be. All of that was done very, very iteratively with the stakeholder community. And lastly, you'll also hear about ecosystem services a lot in the next section. And this was a piece where we had a lot of dialogue with our stakeholders about how we think about valuing our community, how we think about valuing ecosystems, and how to integrate that into the work that we're doing as we plan for adaptation into the future. So with that, I'm going to stop here and say that I think that this part really helped the project come alive in the community and really help to create something that we could say this was done not just by our team, but with the Cape Cod stakeholders at its very heart. And so with that, I'm gonna hand over to Jen.
Tonna Marie, thank you so much. We have a couple questions in the chat box for you. The first comes from Andrew Wilcox, who says, hello, regarding your stakeholders in the meetings, did all share the goals initially, or were there some that were not quite on board or resistant to change, denier types?
Thank you for that question. I think all shared the goal of the fact that we were a vulnerable region and we needed to better prepare and better build this understanding in our community. We got into very deep waters when we talked about ecosystem services and valuing ecosystems and how that value could be expressed. There was a lot of deep connection and emotion that was related to that topic and the variety of different opinions ranging from we have to do this because it makes sense to have that component to please don't do this, this is going to be really bad. And so I think, but at the end of the day, I think when you rolled up all the input and we did a lot of ranking and discussion in a very thoughtful way, people did get on board with the overall thrust of the project in each component of the work. So I think that was a sound yes across the board.
Thank you. We have another question from Casey Sabeto. Were you able to take a pulse on values and understanding prior to your stakeholder meetings?
We did not do that prior to the stakeholder meetings for this particular project, but we went in because we're a very connected group of partners. We've done some work prior to this project that actually led to the development of working on this proposal, where we could say we had a fair understanding from that, from previous survey work, as well as workshop evaluations and different things, of where a stakeholder's level of understanding was.
Great. And one last quick question. Could you briefly describe how you selected stakeholder participants within the subregions?
Yes. So that started out with kind of like my work at the Coastal Training Program. We have a big database that we build because we're doing a lot of workshops to community members across the Cape, and also the Cape Cod Commission does the same and other partners on this. So we started out with just looking at, we bucketed people across these different perspectives that we wanted at the table, from business people to local officials to decision makers to community members. And then we put down, just based on our own knowledge level and people we worked with, a wide group. And then we started and we asked for input from across all our partners. And then we sort of whittled that group down to make sure that we were balancing different perspectives and having a manageable group that we could walk through. So we didn't want sub-regional groups to be like 100 people. That would just be too big of a group. But we wanted it to be very diverse and to have redundancy in these groups so that if somebody missed a meeting, you could still have that perspective reflected. So it was a very collaborative process to get down to those names. And we certainly invited and opened for discussion with all our partners and also with the advisory group that was on this project.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Tonna Marie. I'd like to introduce Heather McElroy, who's a planner with the Cape Cod Commission, and she develops natural resource and land use policy and applying these policies to the Commission's planning and regulatory responsibilities. Heather, go right ahead.
Great, thank you. So I'm going to talk about the adaptation strategies work that we've done. One of the early phases of our project was the development of an adaptation strategies database, a collection of information on strategies that can be used to manage the shoreline. And we were familiar with many approaches for managing the shoreline, but we wanted to expand our understanding of the possibilities and ensure that we were aware of the range of practices, the kinds of advantages and disadvantages that might be expected of each, what site characteristics are needed to successfully deploy a strategy, and so on. We wanted to collect enough specific and fact-based information to be able to use that data to inform the development of the decision support tool, which we'll talk about a little later, and ultimately to help improve coastal management decision-making. In recent years, with more intense winter storms and nor'easters, we on the Cape have been increasingly reminded of the inconvenience of bad weather, the disruption it can bring to our daily lives, our work, and our businesses, the impact that has on our economy and the challenges bad weather poses for emergency response. At heart, we all know that extreme weather causes damage, though it's difficult to visualize just how bad it can be when you haven't experienced the brunt of a storm or event or disaster recently. So on Cape Cod, we face a variety of threats. But the primary coastal threats that we chose to focus on for the Resilient Cape Cod project are erosion, sea level rise, otherwise known as sunny day flooding, and flooding from storm surge. Typical of erosion rates around the Cape range from 1 to 3 feet a year, but recent years have brought enough storm activity to result in 15 to 20 feet of erosion per year in some areas. Sunny day flooding is already occurring and affecting low-lying roadways or other infrastructure, as shown in this photo of the island ferry approaching Hyannis Harbor. And storm-related flooding around the Cape is now regularly impacting road access along some of our regional roadways. So we put together an advisory committee of practitioners, regulators, coastal geologists, and others to explore the spectrum of potential ways to address these different coastal threats. We wanted detailed information on the range of strategies, including doing nothing, to soft solutions such as beach or dune nourishment, to solutions that are currently unused in Massachusetts or Cape Cod and maybe untested here, untested in the permitting environment, and ranging to the other end of this spectrum, including the more traditional hard engineering solutions. In the end, we collected information on 41 different strategies that have some kind of feasible application to the sandy Cape Cod coastline. These include non-coastal engineering structures. Also, you may also think of them as green or soft solutions to more typical coastal engineering structures, those hard engineering structures, the default that many homeowners and engineers turn to when they want to address the coastal threat. And we also collected some information on policy approaches, such as rezoning in hazard areas and transfer of development rights programs. We see this adaptation strategies database as a living document and plan to update it periodically as new information becomes available. In addition to identifying these strategies as engineered or non-engineered structures, we've categorized them by the nature of the adaptation they provide. Many of them, especially the engineered structures such as seawalls and coastal revetments, are designed to protect the home, business, or human asset. Others are designed to accommodate the migration of the high tide line or coastal resource areas through the movement of the built assets. And yet others are, by their nature, retreat strategies that allow for the natural migration of coastal resources. The database has 24 fields of data, including things like a description. Make sure that we're all on the same page when we're referring to a given practice. The type of practice, whether it's a green or gray approach. Brief descriptions of the benefits and limitations of the approach. The scale at which it is best used, costs for construction and maintenance, siting needs and constraints, and case studies where available. The database is shown here in spreadsheet or table format. This is how we first collected the information. But the information has been migrated to a SQL database for use with a decision support tool that we'll describe in a minute. Recognizing that a spreadsheet is not always the friendliest way to review information or learn something new, we've also exported the data to fact sheets. The fact sheets present much of the information we've collected in a more easily consumable format. Our thought with these fact sheets is that they may help with communicating concepts or educating stakeholders and help clarify through descriptions and pictures what a particular strategy looks like, how it functions. The fact sheets allow the user to learn about the strategies, and the layout and iconography help with at-a-glance comparisons between strategies. So you'll see here in a more detailed look at the sheet for dune creation, a simple description, a photo, the adaptation category in the upper right-hand corner, or categories that the strategy falls into. In this case, it both is a protection approach and an accommodation approach. The sheet includes the scale at which the practice is best applied, the kinds of hazards that the strategy may help address, and the benefit that the strategy may provide. So the use of the term benefits here reflects a decision we made to characterize really ecosystem services that may be enhanced or impacted by a given strategy with a more user-friendly term. Jen is going to touch on the ecosystem services components of our project in a few moments. The fact sheet also includes information on advantages and disadvantages for each strategy, which can include things like habitat gained or access lost or implementation challenges. Overall, the fact sheets reflect the feedback we heard from meetings with our stakeholders. We asked our end user group whether fact sheets would be useful, and if so, what kind of content they would like to see. Community members had the opportunity to help identify the type of material presented. And they also contributed significantly in identifying the practices or strategies that would be featured in the Coastal Planner tool, which you'll hear about next. So I'll pause there and take any questions before I turn it over to Jen.
Sorry for the delay, I had to come off mute. I don't see any questions in the chat box. Does anybody have a question? Heather, I see a few folks are typing, so we'll just give it 1 second for them to type in their questions. Is the database accessible?
Yes, it is. It's available on our website, as well as the fact sheets.
Great. All right, we will go ahead and move on to Jennifer Clinton's presentation. Carolyn, we have one more question. Do the fact sheets talk about limitations for certain sites or specific sites?
Fact sheets don't get into that level of detail, but the database or the spreadsheet does have information on that where it's available. Yeah.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much, Heather. Next up, we have Jennifer Clinton, who is the Community Development Planner for the Cape Cod Commission. She analyzes economic and environmental trends in the region and engages stakeholders on regional and local planning topics such as coastal resilience. Jennifer, pass it on. Go ahead.
Thank you, Lindy. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the tool itself. The Coastal Planner facilitates conversations between towns, consultants, and constituents about what they want their future coastline to look like. The planner informs conversations about coastal management by providing a factual, GIS-driven baseline that can support community decision-making efforts around coastal resiliency issues. The tool is not intended to facilitate any engineering decisions, especially those at the parcel level, and you'll see that there are backstops built into the tool to ensure decisions are made at a broader scale than that. There are three key components of the Coastal Planner framework. The GIS map layers provide planning context for what's on the ground and what's predicted in the next 40 years. The Adaptation Strategies database that Heather reviewed informs the list of options for coastal resiliency strategies in the tool. And finally, the socioeconomic research conducted on ecosystem services and housing prices informs the output of the tool. We wanted to provide a quick overview of ecosystem services and how the concept was integrated into the Coastal Planner. It was an important and unique component of the tool. Ecosystem services are the direct and indirect benefits that nature provides people. On Cape Cod, some of the ecosystem services we benefit from include habitat and flooding and erosion protection provided by coastal dunes. Beaches are a sediment supply and also provide opportunities for spiritual, cultural, and recreational connections. Salt marshes provide critical flood protection and help regulate water quality. And oyster beds provide recreational shellfishing opportunities and a food supply. In our research, we collaborated with faculty with the University of Rhode Island to better understand how Cape Cod values coastal ecosystems and how these values might be impacted by climate change, sea level rise, erosion, and adaptation to those forces. Our concern is that policy choices often come down to cost, and ecosystem services aren't sufficiently considered in the economic decision-making process. Throughout the development of the tool, we heard a lot of stakeholder input on this component, particularly whenever ecosystem service values were quantified. Ultimately, as you'll see in the tool, we wanted to leave the value component up to our now informed users, and we took the quantification approach in a different direction than initially proposed. There are three hazards discussed in the tool: erosion, sea level rise, and storm surge. The important takeaway from this slide is that we use long-term projections for sea level rise, aligning with a 2-foot rise predicted for our region over the next 40 years, as well as erosion. Storm surge is estimated as an immediate one-time event. A total loss was predicted for infrastructure and habitat if an area was impacted by sea level rise and erosion and a community chose to not take action. Storm surge causes a partial loss of infrastructure based on residential impacts estimated by the Army Corps of Engineers. The tool includes a subset of the adaptation strategies in the full matrix, prioritized by the stakeholders and tools groups. There's an opportunity to add more in the future, but currently these include no action, undevelopment, creating open space, bank stabilization, living shorelines, dune creation, salt marsh restoration, revetments or seawalls, and beach nourishment. The no action strategy is key, as every scenario run in the tool compares its outputs with what occurs if a community chooses to take no action. It makes the trade-offs and planning decisions clear. We'll step through the tool now, which is currently available to the public at www.capecodcoast.org. The splash screen has some introductory text and a disclaimer to the effect of, "This is not an engineering tool. Please don't use this to indicate our support for any particular strategy in any particular place." So the first thing a user will do is select their shoreline location. Users can select a location based on the map or from a list of places in the dropdown at the top. The boundaries for each shoreline location are based on Cape Cod's littoral cells, the basic unit for sediment, supplies, and sinks. We're going to start in Barnstable Harbor. The left-hand panel displays a list of planning layers. The vulnerability ribbon is an important layer, as it's where users can eventually click to place their adaptation strategies. This was modeled off the development of the South Carolina Beach Vulnerability Index. It's split into 100-foot segments, and its darker shades of red indicates that it's more vulnerable. And the location's based on factors like erosion rates, sea level rise projections, existing infrastructure, habitat, and past beach nourishment projects. Users can turn on and off these additional layers to inform their adaptation strategy selection, such as sea level rise and the roads that disconnect from the broader network due to rising waters, publicly owned property, roads, where the sewer infrastructure is located, existing coastal defense structures, buildings. We also included long-term erosion rates and arrows that indicate the sediment transport direction and the flood zones, as well as the slosh zones. In the top right corner, you'll see an I button where you can find more information about the shoreline location you're planning in. This contains information like size of the littoral cell, habitat types, assessed property values, existing infrastructure, and recreational opportunities. In the top right corner, you'll also see these three dashed lines for the menu about resources and methods. And in the resources panel is where you're going to find links to the adaptation strategies matrix and fact sheets. There's a full methodology paper that explains all of the details behind the tool and the decisions that we made and where some of the data sources come from. It also includes a project overview and website, the citizen story map that Tonna Marie shared, and more information about ecosystem services. Back on the main screen, the user will determine their zone of impact by selecting along the vulnerability ribbon. This is where their adaptation strategy will go. These segments must be contiguous, and they range from 500 to 4,000 feet in width. When the user clicks Add Strategy, the Adaptation Strategies panel will show. This is where the data from the matrix has been integrated. Users select which of the three hazards they want to plan for, and different strategies are available based on the ground conditions. The panel describes each strategy's cost, lifespan, scale, and impacted ecosystem services, and sets the expectations for what the strategy can and cannot do in the tool. In this example, we're going to plan for sea level rise and we'll evaluate salt marsh restoration as an option. The output panel then pops up on the right. The top provides a quick overview of what you've selected, followed by impacted land and building values. Blue reflects a protection or a gain, and yellow reflects a loss. Outputs show to what extent your selected strategy counteracts the effects of the hazard. In this case, private land and buildings were protected because of the salt marsh restoration in the area. Salt marsh acreage increased, but it replaced beach area, which shows a decline. We initially conducted a literature review on all the ecosystem services currently available on Cape Cod to set everything as a dollar value, but eventually decided to change course based on our stakeholder input. Not everybody agreed with the process or the outputs, And by sharing impacted acreage instead, users can weigh the trade-offs themselves based on their personal or community beliefs and values. Another key feature of the output panel is that it also weighs trade-offs between taking action and not. Every scenario run in the tool also generates a no-action scenario, essentially highlighting the cost of doing nothing. With projected sea level rise in 40 years, the private land and building value would be lost unless the community decides to take action. So Erin is going to discuss how we've been integrating the planner into regional and local planning efforts, but I think I see a couple questions that have popped up.
Maybe we'll just get through these next couple slides and take the full group of questions at the end.
Okay.
So I'll just wrap it up a little bit to talk about our pilot project. I mentioned earlier that the town of Barnstable is a partner on this project and have been engaged throughout the entire project. And we're really interested in being a pilot town to implement some of the resources that were developed. And so the town, when we first started this process, had a goal of advancing the resiliency planning efforts, improving property owner understanding of the threats of climate change and sea level rise, identifying and highlighting the costs of doing nothing, as well as the costs and benefits of different adaptation scenarios. So as a pilot project, our goal was really to help the town of Barnstable achieve their resiliency planning goals, but also to test the ability of the Cape Cod Coastal Planner to effectively communicate resiliency issues and support local decision making. After the Resilient Cape Cod project began back in 2016, the state of Massachusetts actually initiated its Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness, or MVP program. And this program, for anyone who isn't familiar, really provides funds to communities to engage in both planning and action around local resiliency efforts. So the state provides funds for communities to undergo a planning process which seeks to engage stakeholders, identify impacts facing their communities from climate-related hazards, complete an assessment of vulnerabilities and strengths, and then develop and prioritize actions. Once a community goes through that local planning process, they're eligible for MVP action grants, which allow them to fund some of the priority actions and actually implement those priority actions to achieve a more resilient community. So we were fortunate that Barnstable was actually awarded an MVP planning grant over the course, right in the middle, really, of the Resilient Cape Cod project. The commission is a certified provider of that program. We worked with them to facilitate their planning process. And then we later worked with the town and the stakeholders to build on that process and implement the Resilient Cape Cod pilot project. The pilot project utilized the Cape Cod Coastal Planner to facilitate discussions around some of the specific priority areas that were identified in Barnstable's MVP planning workshop. So by June of 2020, just a few months from now, all Cape Cod towns will have completed that MVP planning process, which will mean they are all designated MVP communities and eligible for the state-funded action grants. So we're anticipating that many of the communities will now be able to utilize the Coastal Planner as they further develop projects that are prioritized through that MVP planning process. And so this, you know, is something we wanted to highlight because it was an unexpected, but I think fortunate opportunity to coordinate this NOAA-funded project with the complementary kind of state initiative that was provided. It really has provided Cape Cod communities with the tools and the resources and the financial resources that they need to enhance their resilience efforts. And so we are an incredibly vulnerable region. I think it's been an incredible experience to be able to work with all of these partners on the Resilient Cape Cod project, all of the stakeholders that are engaged, and then also be able to engage in this state process and initiative to help all of our Cape Cod communities take action. And so we do have our website as well as the direct link to the Cape Cod Coastal Planner up on this up on the slide here. You're welcome to access anything that we talked about today. And then I think we still have some time for questions about the project.
Great. Thank you so much. So our first question is from Ian Miller. Was the planner stood up as an independent tool, or is it part of or embedded within an existing coastal atlas?
It is an independent tool. We had done an inventory of existing tools when we started this project to identify whether or not there are tools that did something similar to what we were imagining, although that's evolved in terms of what it ended up being based on the stakeholder feedback. What I can say is that we have integrated tools that we had already had. For example, the sea level rise viewer is something that we had for some number of years prior to developing the Cape Cod Coastal Planner. We were able to take that tool and integrate it into the Cape Cod Coastal Planner so that now we have one place Cape Cod communities can access all of that information.
Great. And we have a question from Cassandra Thomas. What is the definition of critical facility in this instance?
So critical facilities, the way we use them in the tool were identified by the towns in their hazard planning efforts. So those are the ones that they consider, like, there is no acceptable level of risk due to these three hazards specifically. So they're, like Erin mentioned previously, fire stations, police stations, shelters, things like that that need to be protected. So we wanted to flag them in the tool so that people could make decisions. I think at the beginning of the presentation, we indicated about 30% are currently in the special flood hazard area. So there's definitely a risk that we want to mitigate.
Great, thank you. The next question we have is there metadata available for the layers used in the Coastal Planner tool?
Sure about that.
Well, we have the methodology paper, so that's going to give you the source for all of the GIS layers that are included in it and the thoughts behind the decisions. So I would check there first if there's something specific you're looking for, but please feel free to reach out to us if you're looking for something specific we have not included.
Great. Next question up is, could you please clarify what definition you're using for living shorelines?
Great question. There was a lot of discussion about that. I think maybe the best answer to that question is, if you're inclined, look at our fact sheet and the description that we gave for the living shoreline. There are so many different approaches, and so many of them are hybrid approaches. We had to just sort of hone in on a couple that we felt were most viable for use on Cape Cod and our primarily sandy coastline. So a living shoreline is going to be very different in different parts of Massachusetts, never mind different parts of the country.
That makes sense. Our next question up is, does the state help pay for the planning process, and how long does the MVP planning process take?
So the state does pay for it. The state provides communities with funds to undergo the planning process. They are year-long planning grants, and between the planning, the actual workshop implementation, and then the draft report, or the drafting of the reports, it takes roughly that amount of time. The state has certified a number of entities and organizations as certified providers. The commission is one of them, but there are many. And so communities select one of those certified providers to work with over the course of that project.
Great. Another question, how are you tracking the short and long-term effectiveness and impact of the decision support tool in regards to knowledge or improvement retention, and whether or not the planning process has been improved by it?
That's a tough question. So we have, throughout our stakeholder outreach and through the follow-up rollout process that we've conducted since the tool has been released, we've collected a lot of feedback on, hey, I wish the tool had sort of things, and we've created a bit of a wish list for changes that people would like to see. One would be in the ecosystem services component. People have suggested that there might be an opportunity to have community values be able to be ranked within the tool. So there could be a stakeholder outreach and discussion around what do we prioritize, and then have that factor into the tool. Another one would be that people are interested in being able to plan for these
hazards concurrently. So we definitely are looking at what has been effective when we are in our Town of Barnstable pilot program and in the rollout, but we don't necessarily have any metrics or measures quite yet besides who can access it and how often it's being accessed. We're still fairly new in this process, and I think we're trying to figure out all our avenues to get the tool in front of our communities at this point. So any recommendations or suggestions for those measures would be helpful.
In addition to that, one of the things that we did look at as we were going through the stakeholder process is that whole idea of, in the back of our heads, and we told this to our stakeholder groups, is that we wanted to create ambassadors out of them for this. And so we can say that through the process and actually interacting with those groups that we had in place for a set time and being able to take their reactions at the outset and at the end, I think we definitely evaluated change over that time in terms of impact of their understanding, impact in terms of being involved in the tool development process and that whole concept to design element. And then now we're at actual implementation of use in the community, and that's going to need a little bit of time to be able to socialize the tool and all these resources and then to see communities actually apply it. So that piece is not something we haven't thought about, but we're definitely on that journey.
Mm-hmm.
And Erin, you wanted to add something?
Great. Thank you both for that answer. We have time for just one more question, and it's a follow-up to Ian's question about the independent tool. So since the Coastal Planner is an independent tool, can you walk through the nuts and bolts of creating it? Did you contract its production, and how much was it to stand up? Was the process of deciding a host straightforward?
Well, I'll touch on the last two, and then I'll turn it over to Jen to talk a little bit more about the first part of your question. But we contracted with the Timmins Group, who was excellent to work with. Their contract was about $75,000. Part of, though, that contract was, working with our staff to make sure that we were properly trained on the approach that they were using to develop the tool so that we could maintain it in the future. So the entirety of it wasn't necessarily toward the development. In terms of hosting, we host a lot of our own tools. So that wasn't too much of a discussion. I think we had committed to hosting it as we do other similar kind of online GIS-based tools early on so that we didn't have too much of a discussion around that piece of it.
In terms of the nuts and bolts of creating it, briefly, we knew a few things. We knew we wanted it to be GIS-based. We knew we wanted it to be publicly accessible and understandable by a broad range of constituents, not just engineers or consultants, but the public with some education. But we really, in terms of the process of creating it, we had our internal geodesign team work very closely with Timmins to sort of integrate the stakeholder feedback and recommendations using that general framework. We knew we wanted to integrate the adaptation strategies framework and make that accessible, and then make the ecosystem services piece really come to the forefront, because that was our concern, that the trade-offs in planning really weren't very explicit. So with those sort of as our guideposts, we were able to make decisions along the way.
I'll just add that there was a multidisciplinary team both in the commission office, including GIS staff who are actually programmers, so that really a lot of value added to the $75,000 that went to the Timmins Group. And that team, both internal and with assistance from our partners like Tonna Marie and others, was a very iterative process. We had lots of meetings where we talked through the details.
Great. Well, we have three more questions in the queue, and the project team will has your information, email address and name, and they will be following up via email with you, Margot, Carolyn, and Patrick. And I wanted to take this opportunity to thank the Resilient Cape Cod Project for sharing so much information about their project, and also thank you all for joining this Coastal Resilience Grant webinar. Please consider joining us next quarter as well. And as Shannon has put a link to a short survey where we would like to have feedback on how we did today. So please click that link and give us a little bit of feedback about your experience with us here today. Thank you very much.